If there's one thing that really grinds my gears, it's the way most people draw a rigid line in the sand between friendships and romantic and sexual relationships. Some gestures or behaviors are widely accepted as friendly, while others are considered only romantic or only sexual, regardless of the context. Platonic relationships, as a rule, are almost always considered less important than being in a dedicated sexual and or romantic relationship with someone. It typically goes like this. Friendship is on the bottom, family is one step above, but a long-term romantic relationship involving sex is typically seen as the most important relationship you'll have in your life. In the media, when we see two people who are deeply involved in each other's lives, people will use practically anything as proof that these characters are smashing behind the scenes. And while queerbaiting is a very real and legitimate thing we need to discuss, I see a lot of people accuse writers and storytellers of all varieties as being queerbaiters, when in reality, their intention might have been to portray a deep and meaningful relationship of another kind. There's a unique kind of erasure that goes on with this kind of representation and content, and it's unfortunately rampant. And people tend to get really angry when the creator or fellow fans deny that the relationship in question is canonically sexual, and often accuse the creator or fellow fans as being queerphobic or prudish. And that's why there's a term I want more people to become aware of. A term that is a more recent addition to our modern vernacular that describes an age-old phenomenon. And that term, my friends, is queerplatonic relationship. Commonly shortened to QPR, a QPR is a committed and intimate relationship that is not inherently romantic or sexual in nature. The term QPR initially originated from within the Ace and Arrow communities. More specifically, a blog post on December 24th, 2010, on a website called Kaz's Scribblings. Kaz, the user who ran the blog, wrote an in-depth exploration of their complicated feelings towards the type of relationship they wanted. Feeling that what they wanted was deeper than a typical friendship, but still not romantic in nature. They published said thoughts and feelings on DreamWidth, an online journal service based on the LiveJournal source code, and users around the world saw it and resonated with it. And from there, the term began to spread. QPRs are most commonly practiced in the asexual and aromantic communities respectively, but anyone can be in a QPR. A QPR differs from a regular friendship in the sense that there is often an explicit commitment to one another, and are typically a deeper and more profound emotional connection than just two buddies who always meet up at the bar on Sundays. Wait, people do meet up at bars on Sunday, right? Am I mixing that up with church? I don't fucking know. Feel free to laugh at me in the comments. I'm pagan, I've never stepped in a church before, and I'm straight edge. But what I do know is that I know the perfect set of characters to use as an example of what I see as a canon QPR. And those two characters are Gary and Avocado from Final Space, the hit animated space opera that basically got canceled for no reason. I'm still bitter about it, but moving on. Gary and Avocado are shown to have a profoundly deep connection, one that Gary admits he doesn't even have with the love of his life, Quinn. But the show makes it clear that she's not of lesser importance in any capacity. It's handled quite differently than a bros before hoes type of situation, and implicitly handled with a lot more respect. Gary literally travels through space and time, risking his life and others to get to her, and make sure she's safe and back in his arms. He even goes so far as asking Hugh, the AI companion in their ragtag found family, to transfer every drop of pain Quinn experiences to him during her life-saving operation in season 3. Quinn and Gary would seemingly do anything for one another, regardless of which alternate reality you observe them in. But it cannot be ignored that what he and Avocado have is incredibly special in its own right.
You sure you want to do this? There's a 99% chance that this is a trap.
Traps are just open casting calls for heroes. Plus, you already tied up Quinn, so there's no real rebound after that.
You're a good friend.
I would have gone with great, but whatever. I'll take good.
What is happening?
I think we're about to hug.
Should we?
The siren's call is beckoning us to embrace. We shan't ignore her. Hell yeah.
Thanks, bud. Needed that.
Let's get your boy back.
Gary and Avocado first meet when Gary is serving his prison sentence in complete isolation aboard the Galaxy One. Gary, who is positively losing his mind, finds out the Galaxy One is under attack, and instead of fearing for his life, he's excited to finally have human company. Well, more like humanoid. Enter Avocado, a bounty hunter catman.
I'm not a cat. I'm a Ventrexian.
Ventrexian bounty hunter, who points his gun at Gary's head, only to have Gary excitedly ask him if he knows how to play cards. From here, they go on a series of adventures in which Avocado has every intention of giving up Gary to the Lord Commander in return for his son, but he just can't bring himself to do it. When it's time to bring that plan to fruition, Avocado instead chooses Gary over the Lord Commander, a military overlord to whom Avocado has a long, perilous history with. Even as early as their first real clasp of friends, as Gary calls it, after Avocado surgically attaches Gary's new prosthetic limb, the way they discuss their friendship is handled more intimately than the average dudes in a TV show. Between the soft, sentimental music and Avocado's hesitancy to declare their friendship as something real and tangible, it becomes pretty clear that Avocado wants to be worthy of the connection they are forging. The average person sees friendships as more casual and being of lesser import, but not Avocado. He really weighed what he could bring to the table in their relationship, and even considered himself unworthy until Gary assures him that Avocado has more than enough to offer. Gary tells Avocado that his friendship alone is enough. With this, it can be seen that Gary and Avocado see their friendship as any other type of relationship. It takes commitment, and their connection, this special relationship they have with one another, only continues to deepen throughout the series. The love these characters share is different from the love we see between Gary and Quinn, but it is just as powerful in its own right. You cannot deny that Gary and Avocado's life paths are inextricably intertwined. And while there are some queer platonic relationships that do involve sex, from what I've seen, that isn't the majority, and it certainly doesn't seem to be the case for Gary and Avocado. There are a few moments where it's pretty clear that they are not in a sexual relationship, nor do they want to be. There's a part in season one where Gary tries to get dressed for the first time with his new cyborg arm and accidentally rips all of his clothing off. He shows up, butt naked in the control room, and Avocado is not pleased to see Gary naked in the slightest. In fact, he actually tells him to put his clothes back on immediately and seems rather disgusted that Gary refuses to, and sticks around for a while in the nude. And there's also a very weird, very Final Space moment where Gary asks if Avocado wants to come watch him pee. I don't know, it ends up being a ruse. He's making up an excuse to slip away and record a video to send to Quinn. But Avocado does not seem interested in watching Gary relieve himself. Gary was completely aware that Avocado's not interested in him that way and purposely uses that as a way to make sure Avocado doesn't follow him so he can record a secret message. I guess what I'm trying to say here is that despite their apparent closeness and depth of their connection to one another, there was never really a canonically sexual component to their relationship. They have this playful comfortability around each other too. Gary playfully flirts with Avocado, and Avocado is known to call Gary baby. Something I thought he was only using as funny punctuation until he tries it on Quinn and she says,
"Don't call me baby."
When he calls Gary baby, Gary rolls with it. Even in the pilot for Final Space, we see Gary sitting amongst rubble after some kind of crisis, and lying in his lap is an unconscious Avocado. Gary is petting his fur lovingly as he talks about their trials and tribulations thus far. It would seem that their closeness was already a thing before the official aired version of the series. And when Avocado dies in the first season, Gary mourns him deeply.
"What do you think I should do? I mean, I need a sign, man. You know, maybe rattle some glasses if I should give him some space, or flicker the lights. You know, just a little flicker if I should try harder."
And with the encouragement of Quinn in season 2, decides to adopt Little Cotto, Avocado's son. Little Cotto even refers to Gary and Avocado as partners in one episode.
"You have to forgive yourself."
"I can't. You were Gary's partner."
Which, regardless of which definition we go by, is a term that holds more weight than just teammate or buddy. And when Avocado is resurrected in a sense, they pull another Avocado from a different timeline and restore in him the memories of their Avocado. It's a whole thing. Gary and him choose to raise Little Cotto together as his two dads.
"Look, I'm not going to pretend to know why the universe sucks the way it does, why it robs you of the things that you love the most, or why, for whatever reason, it put me and you into this kid's life. But we're his dads now, and our job is to protect him."
This is something that is not altogether uncommon with queer platonic partners. Queer platonic partners often plan their lives together, live together, and yes, sometimes even raise kids together. And Gary, in a later conflict where he gets separated from Avocado, admits to Quinn that the two of them share a bond that not even Quinn shares with him.
Avocado! Feel me. Feel me, Avocado.
What are you doing?
I don't think you would understand, Quinn.
Try me.
Avocado and I have a bond, forged in the eternal blanket of friendship.
We've clasped hands. That means we've connected on another plane of existence.
Mm-hmm. Aren't we supposed to have that?
Not as far as I can tell, no.
Yes, he loves Quinn, deeply, and seems to only have eyes for her romantically and in the bedroom. But Avocado is seemingly his primary relationship, and if not that, a relationship of equal importance to his and Quinn's. Avocado is a person he wants to be involved in his life, for life.
I got your back. It's back to back for life!
It's back to back for life.
There's room for both in Gary's future, and it's not a competition. You can have a deep, meaningful, platonic commitment to someone at the same time as having a deep, meaningful, romantic, and sexual connection with someone else. Avocado and Gary demonstrate their unique bond by having this bizarre little telepathic communication moment that mentally sends them to a field in a beautiful sunset. And Fox says he feels grateful to have been able to witness it. And honestly, same.
Feel Gary.
I do feel you, baby.
Oh, sweet! We're talking through rocks. Hey, we're okay, yo.
We are too.
I felt that.
We're going to try and find a way out. Feel me. Feel the friendship.
Oh yeah, I feel that friendship. And we will do the same, buddy. Peace out.
They're okay.
I feel blessed to have witnessed that. That was like a lighthouse in this ocean of sadness.
But what is it exactly that makes people deny the existence of deep platonic relationships like Gary and Avocado's? Why is it that people feel like with this level of connection, there absolutely must be a sexual and romantic element? Despite the fact that it's so ingrained in most cultures to find your special person and settle down with them, there seems to be a tangible sense of there being a right and wrong way to do it. You're not supposed to just have a committed life partner. You're supposed to find a committed life partner to be sexual and romantic with, someone you'll ideally have biological kids with. And by most culture standards, it has to be a straight, cisgender, monogamous relationship too. Amy Guerin, author of the book series Off the Escalator, was spurred on to make this the area of her expertise when she first made her blog post in 2012, sharing her thoughts on the average society's enforced beliefs and conventions around relationships. This particular phenomenon she calls the relationship escalator. Guerin says this about the phenomenon, quote, "The relationship escalator is one of many social scripts, customs for how people are supposed to behave and how we should think or feel in certain contexts, situations, or interactions. These customs benefit many people, but not always and not everyone. When most people say a relationship, they usually mean something like this, the relationship escalator, the default set of societal expectations for intimate relationships. Partners follow a progressive set of steps, each with visible markers, toward a clear goal. The goal at the top of the escalator is to achieve a permanently monogamous, sexually and romantically exclusive between two people, cohabiting marriage, legally sanctioned if possible. In many cases, buying a house and having kids is also a part of the goal. Partners are expected to remain together at the top of the escalator until death. Escalator is the standard by which most people gauge whether a developing intimate relationship is significant, serious, good, healthy, committed, or worth pursuing or continuing. In other words, the relationship escalator is what most people grow up believing, or more accurately, assuming, what intimate relationships should look like, how they are supposed to work, and indeed, what any emotionally healthy adult should want. Lots of people, probably people you know, handle their relationships differently and are loving it. Love isn't one size fits all." End quote. Guerin proposes there are 8 steps to the escalator. I edited these down for brevity, but I will provide a link to the page where you can read her unedited wording. Number 1, making contact, flirting, casual dates, and maybe sex. Number 2, initiation, romantic courtship gestures or rituals, falling in love, and almost certainly sexual contact. Number 3, claiming and defining, mutual declarations of love, presenting in public as a couple, adopting and using common relationship role labels, expectations or explicit agreements for sexual and romantic exclusivity, and also ending other intimate relationships, if any, transitioning to unprotected intercourse if applicable. Once this step is reached, any further step can be considered an implied commitment toward intentions of a shared future. Number 4. Establishment. Adapting the rhythms of your life to accommodate each other on an ongoing basis, settling into patterns for spending time together and communicating on a daily basis. Number 5. Commitment. Discussing and planning a long-term shared future as a monogamous couple. Expectations of mutual accountability for whereabouts and behavior, and meeting each other's families. Number 6. Merging. Moving in together, sharing a home and finances, getting engaged to be married or equivalent. The penultimate number 7. Conclusion. Getting married and having children. The relationship is now finalized and its structure is expected to remain the same unless one of the partners dies. And finally, number 8. Legacy. This includes buying a home, having and raising children. While this is no longer as required as it once was, often couples may not feel or be perceived as fully valid until they hit these additional benchmarks post-marriage. If any of this sounds familiar, it's because Garen's relationship escalator is essentially an in-depth exploration of what we typically refer to as amatonormativity. Amatonormativity being the assumption that all humans pursue romance and love, and that we particularly want and need a monogamous long-term relationship in our lives. This term was coined by Elizabeth Brake in her book titled Minimizing Marriage, Marriage, Morality, and the Law, which was released in 2011. There is an astounding number of expected behaviors, beliefs, and steps that society expects every person to fulfill, and every person to accept as their end goal. The first time I heard about Amy Guerin's work, I felt, as an asexual adult who was born the brunt of these expectations in real life, that this must have been common sense. Until I learned that people around me who were not on the ace spectrum really truly believed these steps were fact and were essentially mind blown by this discovery. I then switched to being relieved that this was a real, recognized thing and not just something I was making up in my head. And of course, grateful that it was something that was considered a legitimate area of study. The average allosexual, monogamous, cishet person, that's a tongue twister and a half, treats these arbitrary rules as fact, as real as the fact that the sky is blue or water is wet. But when you don't fit this mold, or don't want to, there is a very distinct othering that occurs when you voice your thoughts on the matter, and said thoughts don't match the widely held belief that this is what life is meant to be like. Because of this phenomenon, I've heard and seen countless people devalue the romantic relationships asexuals have with one another, because they aren't seen as real relationships. There's the infamous response that allosexuals have in regard to asexuals and romantic relationships with each other. The old, "Oh, so what you're saying is you're just friends." It's always said in this really condescending tone, and the subtext here is that A, friendship could never be as deep and fulfilling as a relationship that involves sex. And B, a partner is merely the person you have sex with, and the separation between your partner and your friends is only that. Which I find deeply saddening. I kind of feel sorry for them, because defining your primary partner only as the person I have sex with kind of throws away any other type of intimacy and special connection you have to each other. It discounts the love, it discounts all the other ways your partner enriches your life. It's always struck me as dehumanizing, personally. And then there's the matter of allonormativity, the assumption that all human beings experience sexual attraction to other people, and always want or should have sex in their life in some capacity. And often, this belief is tied to the idea that not wanting that in your life is unhealthy and a problem that needs to be fixed. Allonormativity is one of the many reasons so many asexual people feel othered and broken. We are seen as an anomaly, and at worst, an aberration from the rest of humanity. I've even seen asexuals referred to as abominations when this conversation arises. We are told that it is hardwired into humans to want and have sex, because it is a supposedly deep biological need to procreate and connect with one another. And by being told this, we're being told we're less than human. Am I saying that Gary and Avocado are asexual? No, not at all. But what I am saying is that those of us, asexual or not, who engage in queer platonic relationships are seen as an unwanted deviation from our supposed biological purpose. We are seen as making the wrong choice to be seriously committed to someone without a sexual or romantic component. Or people make the assumption that they must be having sex with each other behind the scenes and are too straight-laced or private to admit it. In my personal opinion, when people kick their feet and scream whilst insisting there is proof of two characters being sexual when it isn't even canon, they're essentially having a knee-jerk reaction to having their comforting social constructs pulled out from under them like a rug. People often enforce the relationship escalator on others by policing how others write their characters and their relationships. And it's not just character representation they are policing. They enforce it upon real people, too. I myself have had countless people argue with me about my own personal relationships, telling me I had to start having sex with someone for it to mean anything, or insinuating that I must be doing so behind the scenes because they felt threatened by having a fact of life now being challenged for the first time. Let's face it, a lot of people don't do well with change, and when they see something they considered fact now being up in the air or outright denied, their first reaction is to try to force others to conform into their little boxes for the sake of their own comfortability. It isn't all that dissimilar to how straight people will often try to force their own relationship structure on same-gender couples, or how monogamous people try to shame polyamorous folks into practicing monogamy. By enforcing the relationship escalator, they are inherently devaluing the relationships of the polyamorous, the romantic and platonic relationships of asexuals and aromantics, and even the relationships the average cishet person experiences that are any bit outside of the expected norm. And finally, I'd like to talk a little bit about a psychological phenomenon called pseudo-altruism. Pseudo-altruism is a pattern of behavior in people with repressed anger, in which they will react with rage to something that bothers them, but will then try to pass it off as them being a better person who is simply concerned about the well-being of others. For example, how often have we heard transphobes say that their transphobic tirade or campaign to remove human rights from trans individuals is actually about saving the children? Or perhaps about saving cisgender women despite there not being any factual evidence behind either of those statements? I think pseudo-altruism is also applicable when it comes to the relationship escalator, allo, and amatonormativity. The average person has been conditioned to think that sex is what makes us human and that for any relationship to be healthy and worth anything, it has to involve sexual contact. They'll accuse writers and creators of queerbaiting and provide evidence and flimsy proof as to why said characters in question are absolutely having a sexual relationship. But the real fact of the matter is that the viewer may really want to feel represented by a set of characters and are upset that their fanon isn't canon. And if it's not about wanting to be represented, it may be that they are one of the many people who fetishize same-gender relationships and feel affronted that their fantasy is being taken away from them. I have personally seen this happen with both groups mentioned quite a bit, but I will say that my anecdotal opinion is that straight people fetishizing same-gender relationships do this much more than the former. By throwing said tantrum, these people are erasing real, profound relationship structures between people, fictional or not. They're saying that you're either friends or you're a couple. No room for a gray area, nothing in between. But the reality is, there's room for all kinds of love. And the last thing anyone needs is to enforce suffocating social constructs upon one another. This is why it's such a breath of fresh air to see characters like Gary and Avocado. Their relationship is never questioned or downplayed in the series. It's treated as valid, by default, as it should be. I understand wanting to see yourself represented, I really do. But we can't erase one type of needed representation for another. To see two men of different species and wildly different personal histories meet in the middle of space during the strangest of circumstances, find each other and love each other in their own way. God, did I ever need to see that. Watching the two of them commit to raising a child together as two dads in a platonic relationship was beautiful and so necessary. Representation like this matters more than maybe the average person would ever think. Every step towards knocking allonormativity and amatonormativity off of their prized pedestals is a step toward a more free, accepting future for everyone. All this to say, we need to stop this hierarchy of relationships and equating every intimate or vaguely close gesture as a stepping stone to romance or sex. who are we to judge whose relationships are more or less important? And why do we put limits on and impose rules on human, or should I say humanoid, connection? For some people, the most important person in their life could be their grandmother, or maybe even a family friend that was there for them in ways their family never could be. Maybe your most important relationship is to your wife, husband, or spouse. But maybe, just maybe, your most important connection is your queer platonic partner, a Ventrexian war veteran who wants to raise a son with you and be a bro of epic proportions as you fumble your way through space and time, messing with intricate timelines. Or a silly human man who got arrested trying to impersonate a member of the Infinity Guard to impress a hot girl at the bar, only to become an intergalactic rogue who was there for your son when you couldn't be there for him yourself. Whatever your most important connection in your life is, I support you in it, and I wish you the utmost best. I believe that there are no limits to love. Platonic, romantic, sexual, whatever floats your boat, it is all valid. And for the love of God, stop imposing narrow-minded views of what a person should do with their life and their relationships. Please remember that pretty much everything we see as fact is a social construct built upon the remnants of previous generations and their outdated views of what is and isn't normal or acceptable. Break free from those bonds. Live your life as you choose to, not what somebody else thinks you should do. As long as you aren't hurting anybody, you have my blessing. Thanks so much for watching. If you watched this all the way through from start to finish, you're a real one. My name is DarkTeaTime, by the way. My pronouns are they, them, and I like to talk about asexuality, queerness, disability, and chronic illness through the lens of fiction and pop culture. I definitely got out of my comfort zone with this one, as this is definitely the longest, most ambitious one yet. This is a topic I really wanted to tackle, as it's something I've grappled with my whole life. I've had people insult me and my intelligence simply because I didn't agree with their naughty headcanons about characters in my beloved fandoms. They've explained to me every little action the characters have ever done that they think must lead to romance or sex, as if I'm some sort of idiot or alien from another planet who simply doesn't understand human connection. Thankfully, I have never experienced this with Final Space fans. So far, all of my interactions with fellow fans have been lovely. However, the older I've gotten, the more I've avoided fandom spaces like the plague, so it could very well be happening in this fandom too. More than anything, I wanted to raise awareness of these particular social constructs, and Final Space was a good vehicle for me to do that. Plus, any chance to ramble about Final Space, I'm going to take it. I'd also like to be clear and say that there is nothing wrong with having headcanons or fighting against queerbaiting when it's a legitimate case of it. All I ask is that maybe don't try to enforce your headcanons as actual canon based on what you assume are absolute stepping stones towards romance and sex. And maybe don't get indignant and hateful with others who disagree. And please don't attack creators for sticking to their own canon. They had a story they wanted to tell, and I think they should have a right to tell it however they please, as long as they aren't hurting anyone or promoting bigoted content. Telling a writer that you know their work better than them is quite frankly out of line and really insulting to their intelligence and their vision. Also, I just fucking love Final Space. I'm still crushed that it got canceled at its peak, and while I'm super glad that Olin Rogers has been given the opportunity to finish it as a comic, I'm also sad that I probably won't ever be able to afford it thanks to the restrictions they gave him and how it needed to be published. Keep on using hashtag #RenewFinalSpace, and please check out finalspaceends.com. The copies are going rapidly, and if you can afford it, I highly recommend you buy one. I just know it's going to be a blast, just like the animated series was, and I can't wait to see Godspeed and all of Olin Rogers' future projects. I'd also like to take a moment to let you guys know about my Ko-fi account. If you enjoy my content and would like to help out the channel, you can leave a tip for me over at ko-fi.com/darkteatime. I also now offer sensitivity reading, so if you are writing a project, be it a short story or a YouTube script, about asexuality, chronic illness, or disability and need someone with an authentic viewpoint to give it a read through, I am at your service. I even have an option for those of you who don't have actual content yet to send over and maybe just wanted to run an idea by me. So if you're interested, check out my shop on Ko-fi and I'd love to help you out. My channel isn't monetized yet and I'm working toward complete self-employment as I can't really work a normal job with my chronic illness. And with all that being said, it'd mean a lot to me if you liked or subscribed, but no pressure. We believe in free choice around here. Dark Tea Time out, and peace.